Our topic, triple screening markers in pregnancy by Dr. R. Satish Ramanathan. He did his MBBS MD in, from PhD in Medical Institute of Medical Sciences. Shot his first, stood first in university MD. And he's a consultant at the Lister Metropolis Laboratory. And first time we have got a sponsorship from Lister Laboratory also. Thank you very much, sir.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Satish Ramanathan. I'm a consultant biochemist. So I'm a consultant biochemist at Lister Metropolis Laboratory, Chennai. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee of this IME, especially Dr. Padma Chandrasekhar and Dr. Chandrasekhar. So actually, this is a double delight for us. One, this is my first IME meet, and I'm so honored to have a chance to present in my first IME. And second one, we are sponsoring this prestigious event. So the topic of my presentation would be triple markers. Are they still reliable screening tests for DS, DSS Down syndrome? So since this triple markers is a huge topic of discussion, I thought I would restrict my area of discussion to the triple markers with respect to the Down syndrome. So I'd like to start with a brief introduction about Down syndrome. So as we go down the memory lane, so way back in 19th century, 1838 and 1844, this disorder was first clinically described. But it was only in this year, 1866, when this person, Dr. J.L. Down, he described the entire clinical scenario of his disorder. So henceforth, this syndrome had been named behind him. So a remarkable discovery was made nearly 100 years later. The genetic component, that is trisomy 21, was added to this Down syndrome. So now going into the diagnosis, history of diagnosis of Down syndrome. I would rather call this as a diagnostic revolution because so many advancements have been made in the past 100 to 150 years since this Down syndrome came into picture. So starting from the exploration of relationship between the maternal age and Down syndrome, then going to the genetic component. So in these years, if you can take this decade, 1980 to 1990, we can call this as a triple revolution in fact, because so many researchers, they went so deep to explore the relationship between these triple markers AFP, HCG and E3 with the risk of these women having Down syndrome. So going to the next slide. So what is the principle of Down syndrome screen? So as we all know, there are several diagnostic options which are available in this DS screen, starting from first trimester to the second trimester screen. So but in common, the principle is Bayes theorem. This is a core principle behind understanding of all these screening methods. But as physicians, as clinicians, we all have, basically we all are phobics to mathematics. So I thought I would try to explain this mathematical principle in a rather non-mathematical way. So imagine your friend is traveling in a train. So you are not traveling in the train, okay? So he is traveling with the person X. Your friend wants you to guess whether that person X is a male or a female. But he doesn't give any clue. So the probability of you to guess that person X being a male or female is 50%. 50% he can be a male, 50% he can be a female. So now your friend gives another clue. He says that person has long hair. Usually women have long hair, but nowadays it is not so. So now the probability of you to guess that person being a female increases because you have one clue. So now maybe you can take it like you have 60 to 70% of probability of guessing that person being a female. So likewise, if your friend gives so many clues, the probability of you to guess that person X being a male or female is high. So this is the principle, basic principle behind all the screening methodologies of Down syndrome. So with this basic idea, so I move rather to my topic proper, which is a classification of DS screen, Down syndrome screen. As we all know, this is a simple classification. One is a first trimester screen and second one is a second trimester. So first trimester includes two, actually one is double markers, another one is a combined screen. So the double markers in turn include two hormones. One is free beta HCG, another one is PAPA. PAPA is nothing but pregnancy associated plasma protein. So the level of these hormones, we assess in the serum of the expectant mother or the pregnant mother. On this combined screen, it has the ultrasonographic measurement of MT, the nipple translucency, along with these double markers. So moving to the second trimester screen, so it contains two screening methodologies. One is the triple markers, another one is the quadruple markers. So triple markers, I think all of us know here, this consists of three hormones. One is HCG, second one is AFP, AFP is alpha fetoprotein, and third one is unconjugated E3. And the quadruple markers, it contains inhibin A along with these triple markers. So first I would like to discuss about this second trimester screen before I discuss about the first. This is because due to the fact that this is a screen, this second trimester screen, which was earlier established and standardized and came to practice before the first trimester screen. So as I discussed here already, so this second trimester screen contains two methodologies. One is a triple test, another one is a quadruple test. So actually there are four hormones, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So there are four hormones. You may wonder why among so many 100 biomarkers which were explored in those years, why these four were only selected by the researchers and this has come into the limelight. So these can be explained due to two common facts. One, these four hormones, they are secreted only by the fetal tissues and they are secreted, transported through the placenta into the maternal circulation. So if there is alteration in the level of these hormones, it is indicative of fetal physiology and not of maternal one. Second thing is, this extensive research in those years, which I told like triple revolution, they have found out that all these hormonal levels showed statistically significant difference between the affected and the unaffected pregnancies. So, but the mechanism behind the association of these hormones and Down syndrome risk is till now not well established. So now we have two screening options. Which one to select? So that is next question. So one common method of comparison of the efficiency of these two screening methodologies would be detection rate. So detection rate of this triple test is 60 to 65%. So this is nothing but, for example, you have 100 suspected Down syndrome pregnancies. It can detect only 60 to 65. Rest 30 to 33 it can't detect. But this quadruple, you can see an extra bit of advantage, 5 to 10% advantage. But till now, even a few years back, maybe I think 4 or 5 years back, a survey was conducted in US, not in India. They found out that most of the gynecologists, more than 95% of the gynecologists, they opted for triple screening, not for quadruple. So what must be the reason? One possible reason could be this inhibin A. So during those periods, there was lack of availability of standardized inhibin A assays. It was done in a semi-automated method and they didn't have a well standardized documented method. But now, a few labs, including ours, we have well standardized automated inhibin A assay. So I am sure in few years to come, near future, this quadruple will catch up and we'll take the place of triple test in the second trimester screen. So now moving to the first trimester screen. So as I already described, so one, it has two screening protocols. One is a double markers, which contains pre-beta HCG and PAPA. And second one is the combined first trimester screen, which contains nuchal translucency along with the double markers. So here again we have two screening methodologies. Okay? So one is a double marker and second one is the combined test. So which one to choose among? So here again we have the detection rate. So here you see detection rate of this double marker is 60 to 70, but when you add this nuchal translucency to that, detection rate increases by around 10 to 15%. So this much significance is this MT inflicts onto the first trimester screen. So you may also wonder, I said that first the second trimester screen came into practice. After a well established second trimester screen, why did these researchers go and explore for another first trimester one? So this could be a logical reason, because this first trimester screen, it gives room for earlier detection and safe termination. So in the way, like, they can avoid the mental agony. The period of agony these pregnant women and their husbands have to undergo to know whether they are at the risk of having Down syndrome babies. So Actually, since I said NT is important, I am taking the liberty of discussing NT once again because I am not a sonologist by profession, but I am putting a slide of NT. Okay, so this actually was NT under Down syndrome. Association was described by Down way back in 1866. So he observed that skin appears to be large for the body in the case of Down syndrome children. So NT can be defined as increased skin thickness behind the fetal neck that is observed through the ultrasonography, either transabdominal or transvaginal. And the optimal gestation age for NT measurement is 11 to 13 weeks plus 6 days. Always we should correlate NT with CRE, that is a crown rough length, because NT has been found to increase proportionately with the gestational age even in an unaffected pregnancy. So these are the factors which should be taken care of while measuring NT. One, it should be done by appropriately trained sonologist who should adhere to the standard ultrasonographic technique, and there should be the appropriate ultrasonographic magnification. And now I went through an article which says that there is semi-automation of NT measurement. I don't know how much that is in practice. So these things which we adopt, when we adopt, we can have a better screening methodology. So this article, I thought those who are interested can go through actually. So this was written by Kypros Nicolaitis. I think some of the gynecologists will know him. He is a pioneer in fetal medicine. So this was actually a recent article, 2011. It gives insight, deep insight to all the screening methodologies in not only Down syndrome but in all aneuploidies. So next, okay. So having discussed various screening methodologies, now coming to my laboratory. This is a software which is available for screening Down syndrome, not only Down but other chromosomal anomalies like Pertaus and Edwards, and also neural tube defects. So this we can call it as a prenatal screening software. So this software gives elaborate information. This is actually information of a single person, a single pregnant mother. So when you can see here, each one of these you can take them as clues, similar to the clues which I was discussing when I was explaining about the bias theory. So for example here, date of birth is a clue. If you give wrong date of birth, then the risk will be changed. Okay? So you have to not only give all the clues, but you have to give the correct clues. Okay? So second is weight, then smoking, diabetes, ethnic origin, IVF. So there are so many factors. Okay? So each one of these, several studies have proved that each one of these factors in one way or other, they are related to the risk of Down syndrome or these biomarkers, alteration of these biomarkers. Due to lack of time, I am not going deep into each of these factors. But the thing is, we have a history form, we hand over to the gynecologist, but they have taken extreme caution to fill all the data of each and every patient carefully, not miss any data, and cross check and then send us. Because when we enter even a single wrong data, then the entire risk will change. So here is a place where we enter the serum hormonal levels. This is actually a second trimester screen report. So we have AFP, HCG and estrogen. So this second column which you can see here, this is the value of these hormones in an unaffected pregnancy. So we can compare the value of this person with that of an unaffected person, and you can arrive at a conclusion whether this person has high value or not. So and here, look at the right side, you have space for writing the name of sonographer. Then if it is first trimester, then you should enter the CRL. So date of sampling, so many data set here, nuclear transmissions. So this is a complete software which gives enormous information about the patient. So when we enter or when we feed all the data into the software, we get this graph. This is what we are giving to the clinicians and in turn to the patient. So as you can see here above, this is actually a very simple but it's a colorful graph, isn't it? So this graph actually divides the risk of the particular person into three. Okay? So one, you can see here green, this is the low risk zone. This yellow, this is an intermediate risk zone. And red, the cutoff limit is 1 in 250. So above which, this is high risk. So here if you can see here, this patient, she falls under low risk. Okay? So this is a written representation of this graph. So you have all the values and you have risk for Down syndrome, you have risk for neural tube defects, so much information. So you can pick it up, whatever you want, you can pick it up and you can go and treat the patient. So this is similarly the software data of a person with first trimester screen. Okay? So I am not going deep into each of these, but right side if you can see here, this is quite interesting. So actually the software calculates a risk based on different categories. One, It takes only age and Down syndrome into consideration and it gives a risk. So age-based risk is 20901. It gives a risk based on the double markers, the hormone levels alone with the Down syndrome, that is very high, this 20203. But the most reliable risk is the combined risk. For example, if you take here, this takes into account the double markers and the nuclear transcriptions. So if you take this data, the person falls under the intermediate risk. It will be evident to you if I show the graph. You see here, where is the patient's this thing? So it falls under this yellow zone, which is the intermediate risk. So but the million dollar question here is, what will you do what will you do for the patient? See, he falls under intermediate risk. Whether you will not bother to inform the patient, ask the patient to come to the second diagnosis screen?
Inform
the patient. Okay, then what will you do? The patient will ask the second, what should we do to the patient? So right now we don't have a definitive protocol for this. But Western countries actually they have tried quite a few protocols, quite a few guidelines actually are available. So though we don't have nationwide guidelines at present, I think we can adopt certain guidelines or protocols which are available from the Western countries in a preliminary basis. So for example, this is an interesting trial, faster trial, which means first and second trials to evaluation of risk trial, which was conducted in the US 3 years back, but it included 33,000 pregnant mothers in US. So actually they followed two approaches. One was integrated approach and second one was the contingency approach. So in integrated approach, what the gynecologists did was actually they requested all the pregnant mothers to go for first trimester screen. They didn't reveal the results to the patients. They asked them to wait till the second trimester. So at the end of the second trimester screen, they integrated the results of first and second and then gave to the patient. But there was one disadvantage for this method, patient complaints. Because the patients, if you don't give the results the next day, they will start probing. So this approach didn't work well. But this approach actually started working well, this contingency approach. So then and there, inform the results to the patients. So first the patients, all the pregnant women, they were requested to go for first trimester screen. So divide these, we were into three categories, as I told you, red zone, yellow and green. So if that person falls in the low risk, nothing to bother, okay? So this is actually a trial. This has not come into practice till now, okay? So I am suggesting that we can also follow this and see the outcome, okay? So low risk, the patient need not go for the second trimester screen also. When the person falls under the intermediate or the yellow zone, we can ask the person to go for second trimester screen. And if the person falls under high risk, then what to do? So we can advise the person to go for invasive testing like chorionic weather sampling, amniocentesis, those kind of issues. We can even have ultrasonographic markers added, like absence of nasal bone. So many new markers are available for Down syndrome. So this is one approach I think we can start following. But for this, we request the help of the clinicians because we alone can't go and face the patient. So another thing is, okay, these are some interesting news actually, online news channels I came through and I wanted to put this because as clinicians and as laboratory professionals, we should be very careful in dealing with this DS, Down syndrome screening. Because there are so many ethical and legal implications in this Down syndrome screening. So this is one case I think some of you would know, she is a Hollywood actress. And the doctor has given her indication that the baby would have Down syndrome, but she didn't have. So she went to court, but she didn't win the case because the doctor has given written information that this is a screening test and this is not a diagnostic one. So this is one case, but another case which the doctor lost was this one. This was in US, a couple sues the doctor over Down syndrome misdiagnosis. Here, the doctor has done a terrible mistake. What he has done was, he has verbally told the patient and her husband, but he didn't get a written consent from the patient. Okay, so at last, what it was, the parents got $2.9 million for this long suit. Okay? So that is why I am saying, so we should document everything what we do. We should get the informed written consent of the patient because it's the era of going and standing in the court for all the necessary things. So this is the same kind of case. So every month if you go through the internet, each and every month you will get a new case, okay, on Down syndrome screen. So this again is Latvian country, one mother seeks damage for, again sues the doctor for misdiagnosing a Down syndrome. So what are the international perspectives on this reproductive autonomy? Like, what would each country think about the Down syndrome screen? So a survey was conducted in Russia indicating that majority of respondents were in favor of this DSP, you know, in general prenatal screen, selective termination and genetic one. So, you know, every parent wants their child to be intelligent. Okay, so I'm also in Russia, it's a fact. Okay, most of the parents, they wanted their children to be intelligent. So they opted for termination of pregnancy and in turn the Down syndrome screen. In China, this was an interesting information. In China, not nationwide, in a state of China, there is a state law that every woman must accept antenatal screening for Down syndrome and in turn termination of pregnancy. It was shocking to hear that news, but one way China, you know, tries to attain the superpower status by eliminating all the children with Down syndrome. Okay, so they will attain a nearly Down syndrome status and that way they think they can attain a higher level of intelligence. But that is not a case in India. We can't go and tell every person to go and, you know, terminate their pregnancies. So India, along with UK, it falls under a group of countries where it is an optional test. Okay, so it is not a test they can opt out of. Okay, so choice we have to leave to the patients. One more slide, that's it. Take home message. So, you know, since I have discussed so many things in short period of time, I thought maybe these points, if you remember, this is more than enough. So one is these triple, so since my topic was only triple, I went to quadruple, you know, so many things, so I will finish the triple again. So triple, these markers, they are the most reliable tests available so far for the antenatal screening of Down syndrome. Okay, so far, they are the most reliable tests, and so you can happily prescribe your patients for this triple and even the first trimester screening. So these tests do not decrease the likelihood of Down syndrome. Okay, so they are not preventive medicines. They do actually, but it does allow for decrease the likelihood of a person with Down syndrome surviving beyond that. Okay, so we can diagnose whether the pregnant mother has a risk of getting Down syndrome baby or not. But this is very important because I first discussed about the legal implications. All expectant parents who are tested need to be given all the information about Down syndrome testing and about the outcomes of bearing and bringing up a child, because this is their choice. Okay, you can't go and tell the person that you should terminate your pregnancy because that person is willing to have a Down syndrome baby. So they have the right to choose, and this choice is theirs. Okay. So last one is, right now I don't think how long this will take. We don't have national guidelines as for many other conditions. So if it is there, no, I think the doctors can adopt a uniform, standardized and evidence-based approach. Thanks for attention.
If it is possible, you need to have invasive test like amniocentesis. Some of them will say 40 years they have become pregnant or they have had IVF pregnancy. They know we don't want, even if I have Down syndrome. No, I don't mind, I want to have this baby. So don't try to push and you have the counsel. I mean, it's all individual people. No, we have in our hospital, there is a girl who is only 24 years, she had a missed abortion and she had a quadruple testing and they said her risk is 1 in 130. She had a previous abortion, she said no way. He is not going to have a termination and then she will have followed up, something like this. So give it for the patient, right? Don't push. Now expensive counseling is very, very important before you write this test. Thank you.
The cost, coming to the cost. So cost of this first trimester screen, that double test alone, it is 1750 something. This triple marker, this is 2300. And together, second trimester, the first four markers, quadruple, that is 2,400, 500, so around 2,000.
How are you compared to the other places?
I don't have the data right now, but almost all.
Almost all part of that.
Sonology. அது 1000 வரும். இல்ல செகண்ட் ரெவர்ஷன் நம்ம சொல்றது யூஸ் பண்ணுவோம். மொத்தமா 3000 வரும்.
Thank you very much for the elaboration. So thank you.